Good morning. My name is Greg Ball. I have the privilege of being the Dean of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences at the University of Maryland College Park. And I'm here to welcome you to today's event, the Order in the House Symposium. I can think of nothing more appropriate on Constitution Day than to have an event like this and to share it through various media with our constituencies around the country. This event is a joint venture between the College of Behavioral Social Sciences and the U.S. Association of Former Members of Congress. We got into discussions about things we might do in order to change the conversation concerning politics, the use of politics, its value to society. You know, it was driven in part by the kind of perception that we see at University of Maryland and you see elsewhere, where the new generation has a certain level of cynicism concerning the value of politics and the usefulness of getting involved in government in particular. And this is an unfortunate trend, which I think is unfair, and which I think one way to deal with it is to have events such as this, where we'll look at the history of Congress from different perspectives when very major changes occurred, which could potentially and did lead to reform and partisan discussion, but ended up with very productive things happening that helped the nation. So I'm very proud and pleased to be a part of this. I want to just make one very important acknowledgement here. This symposium is happening this way in part because of the generous support of three foundations, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund and the Carnegie Endowment of New York, and also the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. And I'm very pleased to acknowledge Jean Bordovich, who is here from the Hewlett Foundation, and thank her for their generous support that has helped made this happen. I think without further ado, I'd now like to introduce Barbara Kennelly, a former member of Congress from the great state of Connecticut, who is now the president of the United States Association of Former Members of Congress, and she will give some greetings as well.
Good morning. It has been said I'm welcoming you as the president of the United States Association of Former Members, and it's my great privilege to welcome you here today on Constitution Day. And the name of our conference today is, I love it, Order in the House, and we certainly could use that. I also look forward to hearing the panelists, the moderators, and the speakers, and I really think we're going to have a lot to look forward to, and we're going to learn a lot from them, and then hopefully after they finish, we're going to have some meaningful discussions that will help us. Confucius once said, study the past if you would define the future. In today's world of sound bites and social media, we often fail to appreciate the importance of this institution of Congress. While the Constitution creates a government with three equal co-parts, our founding fathers understood it would be essential for the future of the nation to have a branch that represents the people. So while the three branches of government are co-equal, as we all admit, it is perfectly appropriate that the very first title of the Constitution is reserved for the creation of the Congress and also for its very many important duties. We know today's Congress has come under criticism, and I think some of us might even say, it's hard for a former member of Congress to say it, but we might say it could be well deserved. But without the Congress, there is no functioning government. If you look and read the Constitution, pure and simple, there'd be no functioning government. And most of us today with this program believe if we look back at how we got where we are today, there are many lessons to learn. And we can learn what will help us get our government back on track. And I think that's what all of us want. I spend a good time teaching millennials, juniors and seniors in college. And when I see how they feel about what's happening in Congress, it could break your heart. It really could. We need a Congress that works for the American people. And if today's discussion can help us better understand how to get it working again, I believe we will be able to consider this symposium a great success. The gathering of experts with fine and great minds is the result of a wonderful collaboration. The original concept began with a few, and I look out and see them now, with a few members of Congress who then came to the Congressional Past Member Association and then invited the University of Maryland to come on board and take lead and implement our vision. And as the previous speaker talked about, the three marvelous foundations who have given to this event and are going to make it the success it's going to be. All of us here are very grateful for the people that helped us bring you together, and as the day goes on, others together to hear our wonderful speakers. And now it gives me great pleasure to ask my good friend and former colleague, David Skaggs, to give us some of a little bit of more background of all this happened, because he truly has given his all, and I think that all will continue so we can continue to have an absolute wonderful and successful future. This is just beginning today.
Well, good morning, everybody, and happy Constitution Day. We are here to celebrate an American invention, and if you'll forgive me or permit me anyway, to just observe one of the constitutional requirements that is built into our unique system of checks and balances, and the lesson that not much can get done around here except with consensus and therefore as a result of compromise. We'll be exploring today the messy business of consensus building in the House over the last 40 years and the prospects, I hope, brighter in going forward. I want to take a minute to recognize and to thank some of the many people and organizations that have enabled us to have this event today. Efforts that have extended over the last 18 months or so. As Barbara and Gordon have already mentioned, we're indebted to the Carnegie Corporation of New York, the Hewlett Foundation, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund for their generosity in funding the event, University of Maryland's College of Behavioral and Social Sciences. It's been a treat to get to work with the many people there that have partnered with the U.S. Association of Former Members of Congress to make this possible. We have had the wisdom and contributions from a wonderful steering committee, the names of all of whom are in your program, but helping to fashion the program, figure out a theme, and even come up with a title, which I think is pretty catchy. And in particular, I want to do a shout out to John Lawrence, as I was administrative assistant to a member of the class that was elected in 1974. John has done a splendid job as chair of the program committee for our discussions today. The election of the class of the 94th Congress in 1974 was really a historic one. I was a baby staffer in that day, coming back to Washington, not really knowing what I was getting into as an administrative assistant to then newly elected Congressman Tim Wirth. But it was an extraordinary experience in democracy, watching a group of largely quite young men and women who had run for office, many for the first time, to change the House and to change the country. They got elected. They came to Washington, they changed the House, and they changed the country. And that was a stunning achievement that has stuck with me over these last 40 years and really inspired me to get involved myself. As a staffer in those days, I thought all of these guys and women were sort of iconic, heroic figures. And then I got to be one of their colleagues, so it was a tremendous privilege to work with many of them, myself as a member of Congress. One of those who's been my partner in crime primarily in putting all of this together is the Honorable Bob Carr from the state of Michigan, a member of the class of 1974 in the 94th Congress. So I will now happily yield to Bob.
And And welcome, I want to add my welcome to all of you. I want to pose I want to pose the question why in a couple of senses. And the first sense is why are we here? Because how did it happen? And that is David Skaggs. This whole idea started in the mind of David Skaggs, and about 18 months ago, he shared that idea with Les Francis and I at a lunch. And so over the period of the last 18 months, David has worked tirelessly to enlarge and create a steering committee to seek organizational support with the United States Association of Former Members of Congress. And then they helped bring in the University of Maryland. Thank you. And David went out and talked to funders. Not an easy task. And here we are today. But it was not, I want to let you know, it was not that simple. In 18 months, we had a lot of fits and starts, some setbacks, and a couple of phone calls where we had to discuss whether it was going to happen at all or not. But frankly, in addition to being his idea, it was his persistence, his determination that we all push ahead with this idea, and that's one of the reasons why we're here. The second reason I want to pose to you is why subject matter? Why talk about this? Why do it at all? Well, as has been eloquently stated by Barbara and others, and you'll hear it throughout the day, you know, in a democracy, the idea is the people have the power. They have the power to decide the policies. And in a democracy like ours, the separation of powers democracy, that is principally in the House of Representatives, the people's House. So we focus a lot in the media, in the body politic, members of the House, we focus a lot on policy and politics. Politics, the struggle for power. You know, that's the drama, that's what gets the attention, and that's what focuses our minds. But today, we want to focus our attention on something else. It's the idea of procedure. Procedure really, in a sense, can be thought about as the configuration of the operating system. And in the last 40 years, we've seen in the House of Representatives two distinctly different kinds of configuration of that operating system. One that's highly centralized, and one which was much more dispersed. And so the purpose of today was really to compare and contrast and gain some ideas and some insights into the two operating systems that have operated our House of Representatives for the last 40 years. And hopefully in that comparing and contrasting, we'll come away with some conclusions, some assessments about which mode of operational configuration is best for performance. And with that, I'd like to introduce the very first panel. I'd invite to the stage Bill Cable, Walter Oleszek, Charlie Johnson, Sarah Binder, and my good friend and former colleague, David Obey of Wisconsin. Thank you.
Robert?
That's the bill.
Oh, good. This is me.
This is Bill. Are you sure with the
microphone? I think you said next to Bill.
Oh, okay. Here's Bill.
Excellent.
Good morning. My name is Charles Johnson. I was the House parliamentarian for a number of years, and I'm honored to be part of this panel and part of this program. With personal friendships going back with many of the former members here and the folks here on the podium today, and being asked only to be the moderator, which is absolutely fine for me. We are the only panel with four panelists. The other two have three and a moderator. So within the hour and a half time allocated, we'll have each of our panelists speaking for up to, give or take, 15 minutes, and then open for hopefully a half hour of Q&A. But just a little background, which perhaps suggests why I'm here. I began in the parliamentarian's office in 1964, fresh out of law school, and I came in not having any idea what the parliamentarian's office was about. It is a nonpartisan office. But I rather quickly, even in the mid-60s, developed almost a romantic attachment to the House of Representatives, listening to the debates on civil rights, voting rights, Vietnam in the 60s, and seeing how debates, pre-television at least, could influence votes. Now, the seniority system was in full force in effect when I got there. There were obviously concerns about it, which manifest beginning in the 70s. But the primary suggestion I think that this panel will collectively try to impart is that much reform, the seeds of much of the reform that the class of 74 was very instrumental in accomplishing had been planted and indeed had become actually enacted into law or into the rules of the House prior to the election of 74. Now, in the late 60s, and David won a special election on April 1st, 1969, which is totally coincidental, the April 1st part. But
it's made a good line.
Just prior to that, as I look at reform as it had begun, the House established an ethics committee and a code of conduct. Then, by 1970, with pressure to open up congressional proceedings to be more inclusive of younger members who wanted a piece of the action, Congress enacted the Legislative Reorganization Act of 1970 after many weeks of debate under an open rule, which is an anachronism these days. But in those days, and in most of my career, open rules were the norm, except perhaps on appropriation bills. Then into the early 70s, you had other reforms that, predated the election of the class of 70. You had the War Powers Act enacted over President Nixon's veto, which of course established a congressional role in the commitment of troops. Its efficacy over the years has been questioned. You had the Committee Reform Amendments of 1974, which Bill Cable was instrumental in having put together from one perspective. And I'll ask him if he has a chance during his remarks to comment on what was particularly of interest to us in the parliamentarian's office, namely the phenomenon of multiple referral and the quiet impact, for the most part, that's had ever since 1974. So the committee reform amendments and how one faction of the House prevailed over another were again in a reform that predated the election. The Democratic caucus rules changes, which took place all the way through the 70s, and Walter and David and all of the panelists will speak to that as reform that continued. And so when you add those to the Budget Act of 1974, again, an enactment that predated the election, you have a series of reforms that were accomplished, the results of which have had profound effect ever since. So as each of our panelists will discuss various aspects of those changes and others, including the so-called Obie Commission reforms later on in the 1970s, which were more administrative, I think you'll begin to get a picture that will put this whole day into perspective as Subsequent panels will talk about the Republican response and then reforms going forward. So my first, I'm honored as our first panelist to introduce former Representative David Obie, whom I said was elected in a special election in April of 69 to fill the seat vacated by Mel Laird, who became Secretary of Defense. And David and I became very good friends over the years. He had notions of the appropriations process, which normally jive with the notions that some parliamentarians had, not always, but the Budget Act imposed a real new element into that process. So without further ado, David, I'll invite you to make your presentation.
All right. I wish Joe Crippa were here this morning because Joe, who's no longer with us, served as the staff director for this class shortly after these reforms were passed. But to understand why the reforms were necessary, I think you need to understand what the House was like in those days, how power was distributed, what it was like as a place to work. In those days, the Democrats were nominally in control in the majority, but the House was often dominated by the conservative coalition, Republicans, and largely Southern Democrats. So these reforms were born out of policy frustration. That was a powerful driver for those reforms, and also a personal unhappiness. One of the main reasons is simply that a lot of the people who ran the House in those days were arrogant, arbitrary, and insufferable, and that was on a good day. I want to tell you a couple of stories to illustrate what I mean. Right after I was elected in 69, I had a two-room office suite in the back of the Longworth building, and then I had an annex way down the hall, and I was looking for a way to unify my staff. And so I called Carl Albert, who was then the majority leader, and asked him who had this room across the hall that never seemed to be used. He checked and he said, it's Wayne Hayes. I had no idea who Wayne Hayes was, but I called him. I explained what it was I was looking for. I asked him if he'd be interested in trading rooms so I could pull my staff together. He said, I'll be right over. I thought, that's terrific. I didn't expect this. He walked into my office, pulled out a bunch of keys from his pocket. He said, kid, come here. We went across the hall. He unlocked the door, and in that room, from ceiling to floor, I saw crated French furniture. He said to me, now look, I belong to the North Atlantic Assembly. I go to Europe twice a year. I use the Air Force plane. I bring this furniture back here. I'm storing it. I'm gonna use it to furnish my new house in Steubenville. Now, you wouldn't want me to risk scratching it to do a favor for some chicken blank freshman, would you? I said, no, sir. That was the last conversation I had with Wayne Hayes. John Rooney from New York. I was elected to the Appropriations Committee right after I got here. I was very lucky. For the first year and a half, all of that congressional session, I did not say one word in full committee. That's the way you were supposed to behave in those days, shut up and learn. So I didn't say a word. Then with the turn of the Congress, Sid Yates from Illinois offered a motion in the full committee to make our public hearings public. Until then, they were closed. And Sid gave his pitch. I stood up finally to give my maiden speech in the committee. And before I could say a word, John Rooney, this crusty old member from New York, said in a very loud stage whisper, sit down, you smart-ass young punk, what do you know? And I turned to him, surprised, and I said, what do you know, you senile old goat? The senior members of the committee had a collective heart attack. But Rooney took an instant liking to me, and we got along fine after that. That's the way it was in those days. Now, I know our focus is supposed to be the reforms of 1974, but as Charlie has indicated, a number of them started, they were actually passed in 72 and not implemented until 1974. The agenda of those reforms was largely set by Dick Bowling in two books that he wrote, Power in the House and House Out of Order. The theme of those reforms was simply that we needed to rein in the unaccountable power centers, the unelected committee chairmen, and we needed to strengthen the accountable elected party leadership. And so that's what we did. What we did in appropriations, I think, is a good example. For all other committees in the House, the seniority that counted if you wanted to get ahead was seniority on the full committee. But on appropriations, what counted was the seniority you had on your subcommittee. You ascended to subcommittee chairmanships on the basis of subcommittee, not full committee seniority. And since all vacancies to those subcommittees were filled by the chairman, in those days George Mahon, the chairman would determine for decades to come who would be chairman of those committees. And Mahon used his appointing power to stack key subcommittees like defense and labor age with Southern conservatives, and he put progressives, with few exceptions, on some of the less important subcommittees. To change that, I worked with Dick Conlon, the executive director of DSG, to fashion a change that would allow sitting members to grandfather up to two subcommittee assignments, after which individual members could choose one of their own choosing, and then the chairman would fill in the remaining gaps with his own appointments. I went to Carl Albert, who was the majority leader. He supported me on it. We got it adopted in the caucus. It passed, but it was only partially implemented by Mahon. He resisted. 2 years later, with the arrival of the class of 74, the dynamics had changed. Phil Burton had drafted an amendment for all authorizing committees that went far beyond my amendment, and it gave members the right to select all of their subcommittee slots. I modified my amendment to fit in with Phil's, and both amendments passed, and that was the beginning of massive change in the Appropriations Committee and the authorizing committees in terms of assignments. I also was able to pass another amendment in the caucus at that time, which required all of the subcommittee chairs on appropriations to be subjected to a vote in the caucus. Up until that time, if you rose to be the senior guy in the subcommittee, you were chairman, nobody could do anything about it. So we got that change passed. The Cardinals, as they called them in those days, were highly offended by that action, but it meant that they were more responsive to the House as a whole. Then the caucus moved to implement rules changes that it had adopted 2 years ago. The power of appointing members to committees across the caucus had been in the hands of the Ways and Means Committee, chaired by Wilbur Mills. But we had changed that to move that power to the steering committee headed by the leadership. And we used those reforms in addition to dump three committee chairs, Eddie Hebert, Wright Patman, and Bob Pogue. We did not attack those committee chairmen by attacking their political philosophy. Instead, Dick Conlon worked with people at Common Cause like Dave Cohen, and they prepared a report analyzing which committee chairs had been abusive and which had been fair in the way they ran their operations. And then that report was used by Common Cause as its own to be an outside critique of the chairs, and that's what we used in order to dump those chairmen. Now, those reforms have been questioned through the years by some people who say that they made it harder for the leadership to get things done. I think that criticism is off the mark. It made it harder for committee chairmen to get things done, but it enhanced the power of party leaders vis-a-vis committee chairs, which was our intention. There were other changes. One of the most important was to institute roll calls during the amendment stage in the Committee of the Whole. Before that change, when you were debating the bill in the amending process, you could not get a roll call vote. If you passed on a standing vote or on a teller vote, if you passed an amendment on the floor, then often the chairman of the committee, when they went back on the House floor, they could then get a re-vote on that amendment, and that would be a roll call vote. But that's the only time you had a roll call vote in the amending process. The reforms changed that, and that change meant, on the positive side, that the public could figure out what their representative had voted for and voted against. That was the positive result. The negative side, which I think was more important, is that it gave every single issue group in the country the power to push their pet amendment, get a vote on it, and then turn it into a 30-second gotcha TV ad in the next campaign. And campaign committee chairmen for the caucuses could do the same thing. One other point on that score. When the Republicans were in the minority, they often objected when we would bring appropriations to the floor under anything but an open rule. The problem was, if we had an open rule, then the minority could engage in filibuster by amendment by simply dumping out 100 amendments, and in that way you could not finish your work. So some would pine today for the good old days of open rules, but understand, in those days, open rules meant nothing because you could not get a roll call vote during that so-called open rule process. And so I think it's important for people to understand that. There were other changes that we made as well. As Charlie mentioned, I chaired the commission which tried to reorganize the House administratively and which also wound up modernizing the code of ethics. We put limits on outside income because of conflict of interest. We reduced and then eliminated honoraria so members could no longer go down to a breakfast with a special interest group, collect a $1,000 speaking fee, and then be voting on their legislation a few hours later. We also said no law practice. Now, members like Claude Pepper and Donnie Vassell made a lot of money in law practice while they were in Congress. And both of them came to me and said, Dave, that's the right thing to do. Eliminate it. It's causing too many problems. One member didn't get it. He came to me. He said, Dave, you know, you don't understand. He said, my law practice doesn't take a lot of time. It's just that as I rise in seniority, some of the lobbies toss more business our way, and I just get a piece of the action. I said, yeah, I know. That's the point. So the biggest change, which I think produced the worst result, was the 1974 Budget Act. And I know Don will laugh when I say this. But the best thing about the Budget Act is that it gave Congress greater ability to challenge the executive branch with independent analysis by creating the Congressional Budget Office. The worst thing is that it totally screwed up the ability of Congress to do the one thing it has to do each year, which is to complete action on appropriation bills. It has made budgeting far more political and far more partisan and far easier to game. It's made the process far less real, because it's largely based on estimates that are easily phonied up. And if you don't believe that, just read David Stockman's book. Before the Budget Act was passed, the president would send a budget to Congress. The Congress would hold hearings. They would produce a congressional response. The House and Senate would pass their versions. They would then meet in conference. And they would thrash out the differences. And at the end of the year, if spending and revenues were roughly in line with each other, fine, there was no problem. If they weren't, if the deficit had gotten out of hand, then the Congress would take a bath in the press and in the court of public opinion. So therefore, there was an informal relationship run by the leadership informally, which tried to keep these things making some sense. The problem is that under the new process, what has happened is this. Congress created an entirely new process on top of the existing one. It created, it meant that the Budget Committee needed 3 or 4 months to do its work, but nobody went to God to ask him to add 4 months to the calendar. And so it has really slowed down the ability of the Appropriations Committee to move. And if you want to understand why the Congress is having so much trouble today on budgeting, I think it's very simple. When the Budget Committee produces a budget resolution, which is in line roughly with the reality as seen, say, by the Ways and Means Committee with respect to revenue, then you've got a chance to get things done. Same thing with appropriations. If the Budget Committee produces numbers that the Appropriations Committee thinks will give them enough room to do their work, then things move ahead. But if the Budget Committee doesn't do that, then what happens is what happened a year and a half ago, when the House passed the budget resolution, and then poor Hal Rogers had to bring bills to the floor reflecting what the limitations were in the budget resolution. And at that point, members who had voted for the budget resolution would look at the transportation bill that Hal brought to the floor, and they'd say, "You want me to vote to cut what? You're crazy. I ain't going to do it." And they didn't do it, and that has bogged down the whole process. So that's the problem that I see with the budget act. One last point. I think it's important to understand how legislatures need to work to be most effective. The way I see it, the role of party leadership is to lay out for the committee chairs and for the committees as a whole where the leadership wants to go. And then their wishes need to be leavened by the knowledge that individual committees and individual committee members have picked up through the years so that you can modify the leadership recommendations so that they will survive their first contact with political reality. That's the way it's supposed to work. But if the leadership allows the Budget Committee to produce numbers which are overly optimistic or unrealistic, then you run into trouble and you face impending disaster each year. I'll close by telling one story to illustrate what I mean. Bill Young was chairman of the Appropriations Committee for a number of years when I was his ranking member. We were very good friends. I loved the man. And he told me this story. While he was chairman, the House had been stalled. As you know, the way the budget works is the budget resolution is passed, and then the Budget Committee gives an allocation to the Appropriations Committee so the committee knows how much money they have to spend. And so Bill got a call from the Speaker's office. And he said, "Bill, come down here right away. We've got a problem. We've got a little revolt on our hands. We need to deal with it." So Bill went into the Speaker's office. And the Speaker said, "Bill, how soon can you have appropriation bills on the floor?" Bill said, "Well, first I have to have an allocation." And the Speaker said, "What's an allocation?" Now, when that happens, I mean, that illustrates that if the leadership does not have the technical knowledge or the substantive knowledge, then you have to have the fallback of the committees that are supposed to know the most about those issues so that you have a balance between the leadership's obligation to push for what they believe in and the committee's obligation to make those packages reasonable by listening to people who may have spent 20 or 30 years learning the ropes in their field. So that That, to me, that's the Congress's biggest problem today, other than the fact that there are also so many anti-institutional people who have come to the Congress lately, that it's hard. It is hard for any Congress to have a good name when nobody ever says anything good about it. And that's happened for a long time. One last point. 20 years ago, when Phil Jones represented CBS News on Capitol Hill, I was very unhappy with an article that he'd written, or I mean with a piece that he had run on CBS, because it really badmouthed the Congress, I thought, unfairly. So I raised hell with him about it. He said, "Oh, big grow up." He said, "Fact is, I've got standing orders from my New York editor. Never send a positive story on Congress. It will not be run." Now, you've got a lot of people in the press and in the Congress today who seem to practice that same thing, and therein, I think, lies a very large part of the problem.
Thank you, Dave. The next panelist is Walter Oleszek, senior specialist at the Library of Congress. Again, a very good friend and an outstanding public servant, as far as I'm concerned. And he has been a staffer on a number of reform efforts during his time, beginning with the Reorganization Act of 1970. And David talked about what that act did, among other things, was to allow votes in the Committee of the Whole, a huge reform of recorded votes in the Committee of the Whole. One anecdote just came to mind. In 69, there was pressure to publish the precedents of the House. The then parliamentarian, Louis Deschler, parliamentarian for, as it turned out, 46 years before he retired in 74, was reluctant to give too wide an access to the rulings of presiding officers. Rather, they were in scrapbook form, held pretty tightly by the parliamentarian's office. And properly and rightly, Common Cause and other public interest groups and members, led by former Representative Bill Steiger from Wisconsin, became very active to require publication of the precedents of the House so that all members could have access. And one day I was, it was about my fourth year in the office, I looked up and in walked someone I recognized. It was Ralph Nader, unannounced. And he demanded to see Lou Deschler. Now, if any of you know either of those two personalities, it was going to be oil and water. And my public service role was to try to make sure that didn't happen. So I was in the process of starting an index for the precedents, and I had it in a so-called Visi record form, one of the great anachronisms of modern day editing, but it's still in the office. And I invited him over. As he came to me, I was the first one in the office that he saw, and I showed him the progress which had begun to be made. And he looked at it and he thumbed through it for a minute and he turned around and walked out. And a year later came the Reorganization Act, which was not entirely the work product of Walter Oleszek, but I'll ask him to comment on that and other of his involvement in a remarkable career as a public servant.
Well, thank you very much, Charlie, for that overgenerous introduction. And actually, what I plan to do is to talk about the Legislative Reorganization Act of 70 and also some of the reforms of the Democratic caucus from 71, 73, and 74, 75 period. Charlie's asked us to stay within a sort of a 15-minute limit, and so, as I guess King Henry VIII said to each of his many wives, "Don't worry, I won't keep you long." But long enough, I guess. And I should mention, I did come in 1968, and this was a time, as Dave indicated, was oligarch controlled by the committee chairs, chosen by a rigid seniority custom, elected from one-party districts, and that was transformed in many respects from this 1970 to 75 period to hold these committee chairs accountable to the Democratic caucus and make them realize they owe their position not to a rigid seniority system, but to the Democratic caucus, or in the case of ranking, to the Republican conference. The 70 Reorganization Act, why was it created? In large measure because there were winds of change blowing inside the Congress and outside the Congress. And what do I mean by that? Let me just indicate some of the forces that precipitated this kind of activity. Mr. Obey mentioned Dick Bolling. There were certainly lots of reform advocates within the House of Representatives. And a title of one of Bolling's books, House Out of Order in 1965, sort of epitomized how a lot of members viewed the House of Representatives at that time, House Out of Order. You also had a bunch of outside scholars as well who wrote books such as Deadlock of Democracy by James McGregor Burns to highlight the difficulties of getting policies made by the legislative branch. This would be a novelty today. It would never happen probably today. And that is NBC News, in the mid-60s, carried an hour-long special during prime time entitled Congress Needs Help. And they recommended a whole bunch of stuff that might be done. You had incoming freshmen, even at that time, knew that the place needed reform. Probably one of the most powerful statements was a little quip I saw, not a quip so much, but a statement by, if you remember, Allard Lowenstein, Democrat of New York. And he said, just after serving about 3 or 4 months as a newcomer in 69, mentioned that Congress is like the black hole of Calcutta. Nothing prepares you for its horrors. John Lindsay, when he was a Republican, mentioned that, in fact, he wrote this, that the law of the jungle is of a higher order than the law, the custom of seniority. Because at least in the law of the jungle, you get survival of the fittest. In the law of seniority, you get survival of the oldest. Plus, you had large numbers of members who were really wanted change. You know, in 69, you had 200 measures, either sponsored or co-sponsored, on legislative reform issues. So this was sort of the context in which a lot of the changes were made. Now, what did the 1970 reorganization actually do? Just in terms of some major themes, and then I'll move on to the Democratic caucus with an interlude with a couple of comments that I want to make. One of the objectives, which was to curb and hedge and constrain the power of the committee chairs. And the idea was to do this through rules changes. So one of the ways it was done was to require all standing committees in the House and the Senate to create written rules and all regular meeting days and so on the idea that if the chairs were abusing their power, at least you had an opportunity now for the members of that committee to make some adjustments or changes in the rules to control that. If the committee chair did not want to call a committee meeting, there was a procedure put in place to allow a majority of that committee to call a meeting that the chair did not want to be held for whatever reason. So just a couple of points on curbing the committee chair. Secondly, it strengthened the analytical capacities available to the Congress. And also, as indicated by Charlie, provided more procedural information to the lawmakers of the House of Representatives. On the analytical information side, the Comptroller General was given more authority, and the place I work, then and now, the Legislative Reference Service, that was, as it was called in 68, had its name changed to the Congressional Research Service, plus given additional policy analysis responsibilities for the Congress. And on the procedural side of it, yeah, Bill Steiger, Republican of Wisconsin, was the lead champion without question for advocating the publication of the precedents of the House of Representatives. Because Lou Deschler, you know, formidable figure, as Charlie mentioned, with almost 50 years of service under probably 8 or 9 speakers. In fact, I read a little article where he was a sub-speaker in the judgment of a lot of members, because you had to always clear things with Lou. When I was a junior staffer, just helping the Rules Subcommittee that was headed by Bernie Sisk and Dick Bolling was on it, and H. Allen Smith, and crafted a lot of the 70 Act, as did the 1965 Joint Committee that was created for this purpose as well, Sisk always used to have to say, I was struck by how many times we have to check it with Lou, we have to check it with Lou, we got to check it with Lou. And members, of course, realized that, you know, Mr. Deschler had all of the precedents, you know, and he knew them and he knew which ones to pull out to either make something in order or not something in order. So the requirement for the publication of the precedents was really, you know, a major achievement of the 70 Act, which was enforced later on. Minority rights, some things in that score. One of those was to provide additional permanent staff to the minority, two permanent, one clerical, but probably the biggest minority change in terms of staffing was to provide one-third of the committee investigative funds to the minority party. Now, in some of these changes I mentioned, there were reversals by the Democratic caucus. And then the last point I would make on this was the issue that Mr. Obi raised, the whole issue of transparency. In fact, I would argue that the age of 1970, that decade, was the age of transparency for the Congress in terms of a lot of things that it did, from electronic voting to C-SPAN starting in 1979. But in terms of probably the most significant, perhaps, was the requirement for recorded teller votes in the Committee of the Whole. And the sponsors of that were an amendment by Tip O'Neill and Charles Goopzer, Republican of California, were the co-sponsors of that. And how did this, you know, come about? In part because, and I believe, and you could correct me if I'm wrong, David, about Dick Conlin was the head of the Democratic Study Group starting in 1968. A former journalist, former press aide to Senator Walter Mondale, and without question, one of the most significant staff persons, you know, in the modern history of the Congress of the United States. A truly wonderful man, a fountain of ideas, etc. And the DSG, the Democratic Study Group, you know, got started, you know, got started in the mid-50s by a group of people such as Gene McCarthy, Lee Metcalf, Frank Thompson, Stuart Udall, and small group, but obviously grew over time and they made a small progress. But then in 1968, the Democratic Study Group had the wisdom to hire Dick Conlin. And as a former journalist, he probably knew and understood that a lot of editorial writers around the country, boy, anti-secrecy, there's a theme for you. And I'm sure that probably Conlin sent out maybe draft editorials to newspaper editors around the country, spotlighting the issue of secrecy in the House of Representatives. The Vietnam War is underway. Nobody knows how members are voting yay or nay on the issue. And so Dick came up, I believe, with this idea that was run by the leaders of the DSG, people like, you know, Don Frazier and Jim O'Hara and others. And they, of course, signed on. And he may have also enlisted, I'm not absolutely certain on this, what we call gallery spotters. They would get some staff people, I think 40 were trained, to try to memorize, they could see the face of the lawmaker going up the aisle because they got the back, but not the face so much, but the features, the physical features of these lawmakers, and then indicate how they voted, which line they went up, yay or nay, and then that material was reported back to Conlin, who shipped it off, you know, to the appropriate newspaper editors, and you know, sometimes they got it right, the gallery spotters, and sometimes they got it wrong. And if they got it wrong, maybe sometimes deliberately, I have no way of knowing. That created a howl by the member who had his vote miscast, if you will, in the press. And so lawmakers, I believe, began to have the sense that, well, if they're going to record our votes in the Committee of the Whole, the prime amending forum for the institution, then at least they ought to be able to do it right. And as a result, the O'Neill-Goopzer amendment, you know, made it through without too much difficulty. Well, this law was 5.5 years in the making, and I want to transition now to the Democratic caucus and what it did. But a couple of points I want to make before that, and that is why the caucus? Why was the caucus chosen as a forum? Prior to that time, a lot of the changes were simply try to amend House rules. Well, as we all know, on the House floor, you would have this conservative coalition of Southern Democrats and Republicans, and hey, it's hard to get reform when a lot of people are resistors, if you will, to that change. And so Don Frazier, O'Hara, Thompson, others of the DSG, hey, they wanted to have regular monthly meetings of the caucus, the Democratic caucus, which heretofore was largely a moribund institution. It elected the party leaders and fundamentally went out of business. Speaker Rayburn, you can be sure, hardly ever used it. In one of his books, Boling indicated that he didn't like to call it because it would divide Southern Democrats and Northern Democrats over civil rights, and so why have that clash? He probably also didn't want anybody to even think of challenging his authority through some kind of effective Democratic caucus. And what was a triggering mechanism, because you had advocates urging Speaker McCormick to hold regular monthly meetings, to allow it at least, was Mo Udall decided to challenge John McCormick for the speakership. You know, he decided because Nixon's in the White House, December 1968, I'm going to take him on. I'll probably lose. But nonetheless, he did. He lost. But there was enough sentiment against McCormick. And combined with, you know, the Frazier and O'Hare and other people urging McCormick to create, allow regular monthly meetings, you know, they were held. It's not as if they started off dramatically. I mean, there was absenteeism. You know, it took a while before the idea took root and flourished. But the reformers, like Frazier and others, indicated, now, this was the forum that produced consequential change. You know, members could talk there. They could evaluate all the different proposals, vent, whatever. So that's one point I want to make. The second point I want to make, and Bill's probably going to chat about this, in a moment, and that is Conlon and the DSG leadership also had the idea that the reforms ought to emanate out of a caucus committee, not necessarily out of the Democratic study group. I mean, they could provide and did provide lots of ideas. They proposed lots of them. They funneled them through the Hansen Committee after Julia Butler Hansen, Appropriations Subcommittee Chair. And that's what occurred. They recommended that there be a caucus committee, and one was established, and as I mentioned, Hansen chaired it, and Bill, I'll leave the rest of it to you. The last point before I just mention quickly these caucus changes is, you know, I have to talk about the Democrats, because the Democrats were in charge, obviously, and they made these changes that, you know, reined in the power of these committee chairs. But I also want to stress that the minority Republicans were also very active in reforms. In the 1970 Act, this may surprise many of you, that one of the reform advocates and champions was Donald Rumsfeld. In fact, he created a group called Rumsfeld's Raiders that worked across the aisle. This is a bipartisan effort to try to get Speaker McCormick to bring in 1968, the Legislative Reorganization Act of 67, that the Senate had passed overwhelmingly. Well, it didn't happen. You know, it didn't happen. And throughout, you know, the 70s period that we're talking about, and even beyond, Republicans were very active in advocating all kinds of changes. Not only, you know, people like, you know, Barbara Conable, who headed, you know, a task force on seniority of the Republican Conference, Bill Frenzel, who headed a task force on congressional reform, Don Wolfensberger's boss, John Anderson, the chair of the Republican Conference. I mean, the congressional record was replete with all kinds of reform statements and ideas. They even had a book called We Propose, a Modern Congress, with authors all Republican members of either the House or the Senate. Now, obviously, a lot of Democrats and I might not support these kinds of changes, but nonetheless. Now, in terms of the Democratic caucus, let me quickly and run through them, and these are just the highlights. In 1971, you had really a major change. Well, they're all significant in many ways, and that was that no Democrat could head more than one legislative subcommittee. And the whole idea there was, let's spread the action. Spread the action. Let's diffuse power. You know, decentralization is the idea. And so it allowed a lot of relatively junior, middle-level lawmakers to chair subcommittees, and they were very active often in recommending legislation to the floor. Another one, they established a ballot procedure, a procedure, not a ballot necessarily, a challenge procedure for forcing automatic votes on nominees to be committee chairs. 10 people had to stand up, a 10-person challenge procedure in order to force this kind of a vote on a committee chair. Let me move on to 73. 73, a lot of people didn't like this 10-person challenge procedure because you had to stand up in public and say, I demand a vote, you know, on Congress Chairman X here. As Chet Holifield said, the chair of the Government Appropriations Committee, he liked the 10-person challenge procedure. He said, I want to know who's stabbing me in the back. So you had an amendment offered, 20% of the caucus stood up, then you could have an automatic vote, and that was, I think, another Tip O'Neill recommendation. A real big one was the establishment of something called a Subcommittee Bill of Rights. And what the Subcommittee Bill of Rights did was to say on each standing committee, there would be a Committee Democratic Caucus. And the Committee Democratic Caucus would decide who would become the committee chair. And there was a bidding process based on seniority. And a person who said, I wanted to be this, to head this subcommittee, would be subject to an election by his colleagues, the Committee Democratic Caucus. All subcommittees had to have a fixed jurisdiction, they had an adequate budget, they had to have staff, bills had to be referred to them. So this was the Subcommittee Bill of Rights. As Mr. Obey indicated in one of his remarks, I mean, you also had the revival of, again, another sort of moribund entity, the Steering Committee they used to have. I don't know what it steered, but they added to it the Steering and Policy Committee to see if they could get more policy direction for Democrats, and added to it, you know, the Speaker, Majority Leader, and I think the Caucus Chair. And then you reach the high watermark, if you will, of change. I'm not sure whether or not the energy and momentum for reform was dissipating or not, but it was certainly accelerated when the class of 1974 was elected. 75 new Democrats elected to the House of Representatives in the wake of Watergate. Huge election. And this class was different in a whole lot of ways in terms of the kind of energy they had, their independence, their pragmatism, their anti-establishment views, their commitment to reform, smart people. And they were different. They were called a new breed. And I brought along, and I'm not sure, maybe even David Skaggs wrote this for Tim Wirth. As the staff writer, ran across this statement by Tim Wirth that characterized his class, of which he was a member. And this is what he had to say. Quote, we were the children of Vietnam, not children of World War II. We were products of television, not of print. We were products of computer politics, not courthouse politics. And we were reflections of JFK as president, not FDR. We were the first class that was like that, and now the whole place is. So what did this class do? Well, probably the most dramatic thing that happened, and they did a lot of things for sure, was they organized themselves as a class group, elected officers, you know, planned what it is that they wanted to do, and of course, they were elected, breathing smoke and fire, if you will, to change the institution of the House of Representatives, particularly this seniority system and the power of committee chairs. And so they invited the committee leaders to attend their group interview. I believe Norm Mineta was the class president at that time, and I read where he had sent out one letter, first letter to the chairs, the nominees to be chairs, and asked them to come to be interviewed by the class. And he got no response. No response. So he wrote a second letter. It was a little firmer, a little stronger. And I think he hearkened to the 71 change and thereafter about secret ballot votes and said, by golly, in that letter, if you don't show up for our group interview session, then there will be 75 Democratic votes against you in the caucus. And if there's one thing all members know how to do is count. And he showed up, but by all press accounts, it was a terrible job by some. And the classic example was F. Edward Hebert of Louisiana, who was bounced by the Democratic caucus. Wright Patman bounced as well. And W.R. Pogue of Agriculture also deposed, if you. And then liberal to moderate Democrats replaced them all. Melvin Price on Armed Services, Henry Royce on Banking, and Tom Foley on the Agriculture Committee. But to close, they did a lot of other things. The Appropriation Subcommittee election by the Democratic caucus was a big one. Another big one was to make the Rules Committee again the Speaker's Committee, that the Speaker was given the authority by caucus rule to name the chair and all the majority party members of the House Rules Committee. In terms of the assignment process that Mr. Obi mentioned as well, the Steering and Policy Committee, they stripped the Committee on Committees, Ways and Means Democrats, from doing that job and gave it to the new Steering and Policy Committee, or revived Steering and Policy Committee. They eliminated the Internal Security Committee. They recommended a House rule, which is agreed to, in terms of this transparency idea, open conference meetings. Not that they're always open conference meetings, but the presumption is there, and they've often headed more subcommittees. So to end, I guess I can see you're getting antsy, Charlie. Yeah, to end, the place was transformed in this roughly 1970 to 1975 period, not only in terms of the internal configuration of power, even in legislative executive challenges and relationships with the War Powers Resolution and anything else. So small things, incrementally it was done, start the caucus, and you move forward to really adopt and create consequential developments involving power distribution in the chamber. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. I was trying to flag you down earlier, but I knew I couldn't.
You should have hit me.
Our next panelist, Bill Cable, is again a good friend and a Renaissance staff person, a product of the House of Representatives, if there ever was one. And I first knew him when he was on the Committee on Education and Labor, one of the great staffs in the 60s. Involving a number of counsel who together performed a wonderful public service for the Congress. Then I'll never forget when Jimmy Carter was elected president, and there was some concern about the effectiveness of the Carter presidency's legislative liaison office. And Bill Cable, who by that time I think was on the House Administration Committee staff, was suggested, named as the next, as a liaison, the liaison for President Carter. And I called the Capitol Police and asked for a sign, a street sign. And Wilbur McDonald, who could do anything, the heart of the challenge, the more he liked it, brought in a Pennsylvania Avenue street sign, the real thing. And we had it, sent it to the architect's office, and they did a two-way street arrow, attached it to the Pennsylvania Avenue sign, and it was presented to Bill amid much fanfare. And it, I think Pennsylvania Avenue, at least from time to time, became more of a two-way street. He came back after Timmons and Company and had some fantastic involvement with the Chief Administrative Officer, Jay Egan, and then with the Congressional Ethics Office, as David Skaggs will attest, I suggested that Bill be brought on very temporarily as a liaison staffer while he's still there, and then as Chief of Staff to Steny Hoyer. So together, I'll ask a real public servant to make his presentation.
Thank you. That sign still hangs proudly in my office at the House. I have a picture of it with President Carter on one side of it with me and Speaker O'Neill on the other side of it with Hubert Humphrey in his last days of being able to come out and do public things. It was done at a White House morning breakfast, and it's really kind of the my proud epitome of what I tried to do for 4 years. I'm not sure I did it all, but I worked hard at it. But anyway, thank you for remembering that. It's still there. I'm not going to do anything other than basically agree with everything that Dave Obey and Walter said about committee reform. But I want to take a few minutes just to talk about one of them that we haven't really covered very much, and that was the year and a half or year and three quarters that the in 73-74, where the Rules Committee created, the House created a Select Committee on Committees, and it was made up of 10 members of the House, 5 Democrats, 5 Republicans. Dick Bowling was the chairman. David Martin was the co-chair. And they spent a year, probably a little more than a year, maybe not quite, engaging in a process with all kinds of interested parties and public hearings about how the rules of committees, the jurisdictions of committees, and the rules governing them could be changed, should be changed, to make the House a more functional place, to work better. And after that year, in December of 1973, Walter shared with me an article from CQ, so I actually got my dates right. they produced an interim, a preliminary report of what the committee jurisdictions should look like. And there were about 3 major committees that were not particularly, that were particularly impacted by it. All committees were impacted, but education and labor was split into 2, into an education committee and a labor committee. Ways and Means was stripped of a whole bunch of its authority that went around to various places. Merchant Marine was eliminated, intelligence was eliminated. And the point of that is that you can read that history if you're interested, but it created a process whereby the chairman of the Education and Labor Committee and the co-chair and the ranking member, Carl Perkins and Frank Thompson, Wilbur Mills and Joe Wagoner from Ways and Means, and Lenore Sullivan from Merchant Marine, and I don't think we had anybody from in the Select Committee on Intelligence. But their staffs got together, the chairman and their staffs got together early in December, and took seriously this attack on their committee's jurisdictions. And there were 10 staff people from the various committees there, and the decision was made that we were going to, as staff, review, keep track of everything the Bowling Martin committee was going to do for the next several months. And so the next hearing was on a Tuesday, and I was the most junior staff guy in the room, so I said, well, I'll volunteer to take the first one. And then, you know, everybody signed up to take the second one and the third one and the fourth one. And every one of those second, third, and fourth guys, who were all senior to me by a lot, found something more important to do. So I ended up doing the entire job of reporting to this group of members and staff about what was going on in the bowling committee. Turned out to be the best thing that ever happened to me in my career. I went from being a nobody on the Education and Labor Committee to have people like Wilbur Mills and Joe Wagoner and Neil Smith from Appropriations and others wanting to talk to me about the memo I had written the night before about what bowling was doing and where it was going. So I went to every one of those meetings for a few months. It was in, they reported in April of that year, and then the Democratic caucus, referred that report to the caucus. And Mrs. Hansen, the Committee on Study, Organization, and Review, was given a window of time, about 2 months, to review it and make recommendations. And I was the committee. I was the only staff person in that room, much to the unhappiness of a couple of the members on the Hansen committee. One of whom we've talked to a bunch about today, and that's Phil Burton. The Hansen committee report the Bowling committee report was a committee hearing size volume, not quite as big as OB's Commission on Administrative Review, but about this size. And I'd gotten everybody a copy of that, and the 11 members of that committee, including Wayne Hayes and Mrs. Hansen, Thompson, Burton, Phil Landrum, and others, Barbara Jordan, Joe Wagoner, anyhow. Phil Burton says, we don't need any staff. This should be a member-only organization. The staff just talks to the press and leaks everything. And so Phil Landrum, who is a very southern gentleman, looks up at Burton and says, Phil, in this very deep voice, do you have any idea what's in this thing, holding that hearing size? And Phil says, well, not really. And Landrum says, well, don't you think we should have somebody in this room that knows something about it? And so I got hired by default on that. And it turned, like I said, it turned out to be a real career changer for me. I'm sure it's how I got noticed by the leadership and how I got nominated by the speaker, Mr. O'Neill, to go down and try for the Carter job. But the process was really interesting. The House debated how to debate it for a long time. There was a 4 or 5 day Rules Committee hearing where they made the two bills, the original Bowling Martin was the main vehicle, and they had a substitute from the Hansen Committee and a substitute from Dave Martin. They had the three major pieces together. They debated it for 6 days. And if you think about that in contemporary time, that's a lifetime. We were on the floor 4 or 5 hours for five or six days. One day was pretty much not. And it was substantive debate about things like what jurisdiction should go to the Commerce Committee or to Health Committee or to an Energy Committee. And it was really quite a process. After the end of the sixth day, the Hansen Committee proposal was adopted by about a 50 vote margin, and it became the new Rules 10 and 11 of the Rules of the House. And I was as the staff person, I was sort of responsible for making sure people knew what was in it. And we created, Don will remember this well, we created the document that the GPO printed for us over certain objections. That is this little 20-some-odd page document that talks about what jurisdiction went from what committee to another, and that was literally the only history that was there. And Charlie Johnson and Bill Brown convinced me that I had an obligation to them to give them whatever notes I had. So Charlie had to bring me one of these little books. It used to have a red cover. The night we were printing it at the government printing office, the guy over there said, well, what kind of a cover do you want? And I said, well, I don't want this gray committee hearing stuff. And he said, well, I've got this old red stock that we print Supreme Court briefs in. You want that? And I said, sure, it'll look better. And so little things like that. One of the most interesting things in my view of what happened there was that this process was maligned in the press as King Caucus ruling the House of Representatives. And it could be viewed that way because it was all Democratic members, but it was a diverse Democratic membership that really did reflect the Southern conservative base, the liberal base, and the whole country. And so it was quite a process that went very well, and it was adopted in September of 1974. And when the new members came in, they were the ones who got to adopt the rules of the House that had just been reflected in these changes. The changes that were adopted were going to go into effect in the next Congress, and their number, their 75, made that pretty much a slam dunk for the people who were worried about how much of it would be undone. Because in the past, as we've talked about it, there were changes made and the rules promised, and by the time the leadership got through with their little package, some of the things weren't still in there. So it was a great honor to do this. I'll tell you one quick story about members. It's a Phil Burton story as well. One of Burton's concepts was that each member of the Hansen Committee should sit down with me, who I guess he'd gotten comfortable with, and tell them what they wanted the jurisdictions of the House to look like without any filter. Not what will pass, not what would be approved by Dave Obey or anybody else. So I spent time with with 10 of the 11 members of that committee, the longest of which was with Phil Burton on a Saturday afternoon in a almost dark office where he was laying on the couch rambling about what was going on, how uniquely aligned he wanted committees. He wanted an energy committee with all the energy stuff in it. Atomic energy, oil, gas. He wanted a health committee with all the health stuff in it. He wanted a labor committee that had rail labor and airline labor and the normal concept of AFL-CIO, big labor. And nobody ever, those were never going to go anywhere, but it was really quite a process, quite an interesting process to have gone through for a young staff person. Thank you.
finally for this panel, Sarah Bender is a professor of political science at George Washington University. I don't claim to know her as well as I know our other three panelists, but I do look forward to reading a book she's just today given me. She has is a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution as well as a professor at GW, and is the past co-editor of Legislative Studies Quarterly and is the author or co-author of numerous works, including the forthcoming Monetary Politics, Advice and Dissent, The Struggle to Shape the Federal Judiciary, and Stalemate, Causes and Consequences of Legislative Gridlock. And I'll ask Sarah to give an overview, as I'm sure she's anxious to do, to this panel, and then with time remaining, open it up for some questions. Sarah, thank you.
Great, sure. Well, thanks very much for including me. It's a nice honor to be on this panel for sure. My own Hill experience, of course, from the 1980s pales in comparison to the collective wisdom on this panel, let alone the room. But I thought I would start with a very short story about a conversation I once had with my former boss on the Hill, Lee Hamilton. I was there for 4 years working for him. I went back to see him when I was working on my dissertation about congressional reform, the dynamics of reform. He asked me how things were going. I said, well, Lee, let me ask you a question. So why is it when you and majority party members, why do you sometimes create rules that actually help out the minority party? And Lee looks at me and he kind of, in that Hoosier way, kind of scratches his head. He says, the majority creates rules to help out the minority? We gave them procedural rights? Well, that must have been a mistake, right? So, which was not the answer I expected to hear from Lee Hamilton, but it did drive home to me and continues to drive home to me the reality of reform, which is that changes in institutions and rules can have both intended as well as unintended consequences. So I thought I would provide some wrap-up discussion of the rules we've been, and institutional changes we've been talking about, to put the reforms of the 70s into this context. First, talk about reforms that had their intended effects, but second, also reforms that might have produced unintended or at least unanticipated consequences. So first, on the question of intended effects, this is not an exhaustive list, but I would highlight what we've been talking about here, what appear to be two intended goals of reformers. First, to make the House more responsive to the interests of the Democratic caucus, and second, as we'll talk about just very briefly, the goal of empowering Congress in its relationships with the executive. So first, on the goal of making the House more responsive to the policy views of its majority, particularly in a period of an emerging liberal majority within the Democratic caucus, how do reformers achieve that? We've talked mostly about these already, so just briefly. First, loosening the grip of committee chairs on the agenda and on policy outcomes. We've talked about sunshine reforms, opening meetings, recorded votes in the Committee of the Whole, electronic voting in 1974. Walter mentioned the subcommittee Bill of Rights, including some sweeteners to get minority party Republicans to vote for those reforms. So how do reformers really achieve that intended effect? First, the opening up, the loosening grip of committees. But second, as we've talked about, empowering the party caucus, making chairs stand for re-election, and more generally, making the caucus the locus of decision-making. I would say, and as we've been talking about, those reforms had both immediate and longer-term effects, certainly deposing several committee chairs so soon after requiring a caucus support for their re-election, clearly sent a strong signal about the new locus of power within the House. And as we've also, Walter mentioned, right, the emergence of very strong subcommittee chairs and agendas taking root fairly quickly. I think it was Mo Udall once quipped, he said, no, with all this influx of new members by the end of the late 1970s, he didn't know them all by name, but walking down the hallway, if he didn't recognize you, he said, I would say, how are you, Mr. Chairman? Right? And half the time he said, right, he would have been correct. So power devolved pretty quickly below committees to subcommittees as well as above committees to the caucus, which I think of as a nice reminder of something Norm Ornstein wrote very long ago about institutional change in the House and in Congress. It's not necessarily a zero-sum game, right, that we have two new sources of internal House power emerging with the reforms. And those do appear to be the intended effects of the reformers. So first, that first goal, making the House and its processes and its outcomes more responsive. But the second goal, empowering Congress with its relations with the Nixon administration and with the executive more broadly. We've talked about fiscal policy in terms of the Congressional Budget Act, although Mr. Obey's comments make me think that perhaps I should be putting the Budget Act in the list of reforms with unintended consequences in their interaction with appropriations. We might also want to put in this category of reforms intending to empower Congress the war over war policy and the War Powers Resolution, bridging that chasm between the president's rights power as commander-in-chief and Congress's power of the purse to commit troops. We could argue forever now whether or not the War Powers Resolution actually had its intended effect. I'm not so sure, but it certainly, at a minimum, laid down the markers for when and why and to what conditions the president should be consulting with Congress over the commitment of troops abroad. So fiscal policy, a clear effect. War policy, I would also add in monetary policy, I think a bit underappreciated when we think about the 1970s and what difference an emerging liberal majority had in shaping the economy. Congress imposed new reporting requirements on the Fed, new audits. Most importantly, it wrote for the very first time an explicit mandate into the Federal Reserve Act about what Congress expected the Fed to do, right, to care both about jobs and growth as well as about prices and inflation. All one has to do is look at the massive monetary accommodation in the wake of the great financial crisis to understand why, right, Bernanke following the employment mandate, which is very unusual across central banks. So those strike me as intended effects of reforms in the 1970s. Just briefly to wrap up then, unintended consequences. There were probably several. I would point to just one here for us to think about, and that would be the impact of sunshine rules on the House, and particularly on the House floor, which obviously transparency has obviously much to speak for itself, and we've talked about the ways in which transparency transformed the House, the ability to request a recorded vote on amendments, Committee of the Whole, the advent of electronic voting. But there are also, I think, some unintended consequences that accompanied those reforms. We clearly saw an increase in the amending activity in the House floor. Obviously, there was also an increase in amending activity in the Senate floor, and they still don't have electronic voting, so we don't want to overstate the impact of reforms here. But most importantly, and this is something Steve Smith observed in the late 1980s, that surge in amending activity was really disproportionately by House Republicans. Perhaps, as Smith wrote, perhaps to the surprise of Democrats. Again, here the idea that there are unanticipated effects, right, with this surge in Republican activity. Another response then to that unintended effect, the response by Democrats to use the Rules Committee, right, now appointed by the Speaker, not Ways and Means, to bring order to the floor. As we all know, conditions start to change, parties begin to polarize, right? We see more partisan voting in the 80s and 90s. We see the advent then of restrictive rules, decisions by party leaders to use the rules to pursue the caucus's policy priorities. Again, all in a chain of events that got unleashed by creating the floor as an advent, as an avenue or an arena for actually making policy decisions, for opening up, making much broader participation within the floor. It precipitates this chain of events as conditions change outside the institution, right, that then creates reforms that perhaps probably were not anticipated by the 1970s reformers. Now, that system can be sustainable and can yield major policy change if the majority party stays united. But once a majority fractures in a pretty competitive partisan environment, the majority party can no longer work its will. And if it's unwilling to reach out to the minority with these sets of rules on the floor, the result is, of course, what we see in the House today, right? The difficulty of bringing bills and working them through to the floor. Would we have seen the emergence of these restrictive rules even without the rules change of the 1970s? Perhaps. There's a long history of restrictive rules. Stan Bach, CRS, has written about them best. But I think much of what we see in the House today, the roots lie in these reforms of the 70s, which obviously were originally in the pursuit of greater transparency and greater accountability. To wrap up, I think these changes rooted in the 70s are an important reminder about the power of institutional reform and about the power of reformers to actually make a difference, to improve the legislative branch. Certainly the 1970s is a testament to the success of the reformers in building sustainable coalitions in favor of change. At the same time, I think these 1970s reforms are a good reminder about the limits of institutional reform. That is, the House and Senate rules outlast, right, both the coalitions that put them into place and the political conditions that made those reforms possible. And that is inevitably, right, a recipe for having unanticipated or unintended consequences of reform, which can be good or bad for the institution, but either way, very hard to undo once those reforms get layered into place. And I'll stop right there.
Thank you, Sarah. In the 15 minutes remaining, let me first take the prerogative as moderator to comment very briefly on an aspect of management, and Sarah focused on it toward the end of her remarks, the notion of certainty of time and issue, the management of time, the management of issues presented, manifest through the Rules Committee. I've told people the only important rule of the House and among parliaments of the world is the rule that establishes and empowers the Rules Committee through its appointment authority by the Speaker, the 9 of 13. Remember the ratio 9 to 4. I guess it's 8 to 4 now. But and then coupled with the postponement and clustering of votes and the packaging of issues to the maximum convenience of members, regardless of party, the notion that debates are disjointed from votes, I think enforces the notion that debates no longer greatly influence votes. You don't have wrap-up speeches of any significance, and you don't have second-degree amendments written in whole cloth by Republicans or Democrats. I know Dave Obey sponsored a rules change on appropriation bills where he saw and others saw a disproportionate number of minority amendments in the form of limitations to force those amendments to be offered at the end of bills. These are perhaps post-mid-70s changes, and they are, and they'll be elaborated on by other panels later today, but unless Dave has an immediate comment on just that aspect of Sarah's wrap-up, if you do, otherwise I'll open up for questions. Please keep your questions to a minute or so, or statements. And we have some microphones that, yes, Bill Pitts, who's a panelist on the next panel, so please keep it very short.
Charlie, just to follow up on what you were just talking about, and since it's Constitutional Day, there's two provisions of the Constitution. One is that each house shall determine its own rules of proceeding, and also a quorum is necessary to do business. Now, the rules of the House were changed to essentially deny any member from making a point of no quorum. In other words, didn't the House decide that debate is not the business of the House?
Well, as moderator, I can provide an answer, and he knows what my answer is already. But John Ashbrook, unless any of the panelists want to comment on that, was a leading Republican who actually forced that to a question of a point of order. The notion that a point of order of no quorum could interrupt at any time during any debate, regardless of the fact that Congress wasn't ready to vote, led the House in its wisdom under its rulemaking to say that only votes are such business of the House as to require a quorum. It didn't say that debate is not business, such business as to require the presence of a quorum, unless the chair in his discretion wanted to entertain a point of no quorum. So I think the notion of debate being business, debate is business of the House, but not such debate as mandates the constant need for a quorum, which disappears as soon as it appears.
This is for Congressman Obey and any others who wish to comment. Do you think it's time to change or repeal the Budget Act of 1974? And if so, how should it be changed?
Well, I was at a forum with Rudy Penner a few months ago, and I don't think I'm misstating what he said, but I think he said that in his view, the only part of the Budget Act that remained very useful was the fact that CBO had been created so that the Congress had greater ability to analyze executive branch claims and estimates on the budget. That's where I come from. And if I had my way, I would, I'd like to simply rip up the Budget Act, except for things like that, so that you would not have added that layer of activity that has slowed the House down. Short of that, if you wanted to keep the existing structure, I would simply say that one thing you might consider is simply saying that the chairman of the Budget Committee would rotate between Ways and Means and Appropriations, or else you would have co-chairs of the committee. So that, because right now, the Budget Committee performs its actions at 30,000 feet with no detailed information available about program impact, whereas the Appropriations Committee then has to get in and slog it on the ground, dealing with all of the individual programmatic realities that make up that legislation. But the problem now is that the duty to set the targets versus the duty to actually implement them is handled by two different groups of people. If, in my view, if the people who were setting the numbers in the budget resolution initially were the people who then had to implement those numbers, the Budget Committee numbers would be a whole lot more realistic than they've been the past few years.
Charlie, one of the things you mentioned was when you were wrapping up was this concept of having joint referrals and that was part of the legislative reorganization that was 73. It was actually in both Bowling and in Hanson at the end. And just as a very practical matter, I went, as we said earlier, I went down to the White House, and in 1977, when the president proposed his energy bill, one of the most important things that Speaker O'Neill did was to assign that energy legislation to two committees and give each of them a deadline to report that legislation. And without that authority from that change, I don't think you would have ever had an Energy Policy Act that could have passed, that would have passed the House, and or it wouldn't have looked anything like it was. But so there are some really pragmatic, some practical examples of how that's been a very good use of a very powerful tool. I mean, the Speaker can, upon the introduction of a bill, can determine the day it's going to be on the floor of the House. Just bang. It's, you know, you get it for two weeks, and it comes to the floor. And it's his Rules Committee, so he can get the rule.
Bill, one of the ironies of the dynamic as it played out when Burton, the substitute, prevailed over the Select Committee's proposal was that the Bowling suggestion of multiple referral assumed that with combined and modernized jurisdictions, there'd be less likelihood for many multiple referrals, because you'd have a committee on energy. You'd have combined jurisdictions that wouldn't overlap. But then when the Burton substitute was adopted, the way it was drafted, it left intact the multiple referral requirement, which had not been anticipated, I don't think. And I've tried to research this through Bill's notes and others with inconclusive results. Did Phil Burton really want a multiple referral mechanism, which for the next 20 or 30 years to this day has played out in the parliamentarian's office, at least, as a major, major change that emanated from not only with respect to time limits. Time limits are now imposed by the Rules Committee through the Speaker by, in effect, discharges of committees. They're no longer very often time limits set by the Speaker formally on initial referrals. sequential referrals get more often than not get so-called token referrals, sequential referrals of a day or so to symbolize jurisdictional interest, but not to stop the bill. But in any event, it's the Rules Committee at the Speaker's request that takes bills out of committee, whether they've been reported or not, and puts them immediately on the floor. That was unheard of in the 70s.
Mm-hmm. I think Phil always wanted to be Speaker, so I give him credit for being foresighted enough to want that power.
He wanted to appeal to more members who were going to have part of the action. Well, we have 1 minute left, and yes, sir.
'70s system that you think should have been kept intact as you look back, that you wish you hadn't undone, or that the observers think shouldn't have been undone?
I would like, there was a difference between Phil Burton and me on the issue of member selection of their own subcommittee assignments. I always preferred, naturally, my own as opposed to Phil's, because I thought that if members were given the right to select one subcommittee and then the chairman was able to fill in the rest, I thought that would give the chairman, I thought that would create a better balance in terms of power between the chairman and individual members. Members would be able to spend some, their time on a committee that actually interested them, and yet the subcommittees would be aligned in such a way that there would be not every subcommittee would be an advocate rather than an analyst of programs. Because we had so many new members in the class of 74, that became impossible to simply limit it to one. And understand, I think not only did Phil think it was the right thing to do because members should have more say than I thought, but he also knew he was going to run for majority leader at some point, and I think he felt that if he could be a champion of the newer members, that he would be able to put some of those votes in his pocket when the majority leader's race came. So if we could have throttled back a little bit on that, I think you would have had a better balance of power between the committees and the individual members.
Our time is up.
I was going to jump in.
Walter, just jump in with it for 30 seconds.
Give me just 30. Maybe I'm not going to answer the question you pose, but we need a better balance between committee and party leaders perhaps at the moment. But what you said about Phil Burton and Phil Burton over here, it's kind of ironic, if you will, almost paradoxical, where Dick Bowling was a champion of strengthening a Democratic caucus, and Phil Burton had the smarts to have the reform plan considered by the Hansen Committee and fundamentally do in Bowling's plan.
Sure.
Thank you. It's been our pleasure.
It's been our pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will now have a short break. Please return to the auditorium at 11:15 for our next panel.